Broadcasting live statewide from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nightlight with Pete Schwabba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a guy who wanted to be in porn but didn't have the acting chops, Pete Schwabba.
Welcome back. Got another text. Where would you go anywhere in the world if money were no object? Because this is National Planet Trip Day. From the 818, Bridget says, I would stay at the Grand Hotel on Mackinac Island for a month. That is a good one. I've been there. I went there on my honeymoon just for a week. Mike, that's like the Grand Hotel is like a cruise ship. It's like this all-inclusive. The grounds are beautiful. There's golf, swimming, tennis, and you never have to leave, and everything's included. You got to wear a coat to dinner. It's like really old school. I don't know if you've ever been.
I know all about it, but I've never been. Can you believe that? Oh, I mean, I've driven through it. I've driven around it. You know, I've worked up, when we were doing stand-up, I did Sault Ste. Marie. I did all around the UP. I did, Upper Michigan and Traverse City and all that stuff, but I just never went to Mackinac Island.
There are no cars allowed. You can kind of, it smells like horse manure at times because there's horses everywhere.
Sold.
I'm sure there's a fetish for that somewhere. But it's just gorgeous. It's got this energy I can't even describe. It's so much fun. We've taken our kids there a few times. Put it on your list, buddy. That's a good one.
I will. No, it's a famous place.
And I'll come with you. So here's my story. Mike and I went to a BoDeans concert at the time, and this is why we did this, Mike. It's all coming back to me now. There was a time in the early 90s when the BoDeans were like U2 in Chicago.
In the Midwest, they were huge. Wisconsin band. But I remember WXRT in Chicago, which we all listened to and was a great, and probably still is a great radio station. Loved them and played the hell out of them. And so they were huge in Chicago. They had a massive following in Chicago. So they seemed to play there all the time. And why didn't we see them there where we lived and rather than drive 3 hours to?
Well, that's what I was getting to. They played bigger venues in Chicago, but in Indianapolis, they were playing the Vogue Theater in Carmel or somewhere. Another friend, Dave Dugan, who is a comedian, very funny comic, who's an Indianapolis guy. And Mike and I planned it. We were going to go down on a road trip down, see the BoDeans, crash at Dave's house. He lived like a mile from the club.
Yeah, the Vogue was in Broad Ripple, I believe, because the comedy club was right next to it. I saw the Ramones in that place on their last tour.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I was doing the club next door, and we just walked next door after our show, and I saw them. I didn't know it was going to be their last tour, but it turned out to be,
Did you use the old, we're the comedians line? That's a big thing in stand-up, for those of you listening. Comics will use that to get in anywhere. Hi, we're the comedians next door. We're the comics. Like it's like you're with the FBI or something. But sometimes it works. People are like, oh, that's so cool. Come on in.
Oh, you're comics. Yeah, come on in. So you got to give it a shot.
Mike and I went to this show. We ended up staying at the place drinking till like 3 a.m. A lot of people from the show were there. I remember it was a really fun night. We were just messing with people and having fun and whatever. And it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and you kind of wanted to just go home. But
we were young and we could have made it back. It was probably midnight or so. And we could have made it back.
No, it was later than midnight. It was,
oh, really?
In fact, I can tell you it was much later than midnight because, all right, well, here's what happened. We drove to Dave's house. Dave gave up on us. He just figured we weren't coming. So around 2 a.m. he locked the door and we couldn't get into Dave's house. And Dave apparently and rudely is a very heavy sleeper. So Mike and I are locked out of our friend Dave Dugan's house. He has one of those little doggy doors. We couldn't fit in that. We even tried to get in there. It's like it's snow. And that's the other thing. It was snowing. It was like a blizzard.
Let's paint the picture of the weather conditions at that point. It was like really blowing. And then it started coming down really hard.
And then here's what we did.
We went down there without a cut set place to stay. We didn't have a hotel room.
We had Dave's house. We had a plan, Mike.
You think we would have, this is pre-cell phone too. People don't realize this. So we couldn't just call him and ask or text or anything like that. So we're pounding on his door at 2 in the morning.
I think I had a beeper, but that only comes in handy if someone calls you and you can get to a payphone. So, So we get to Dave's house. We're locked out. We're like, I go, should we get a hotel? And Mike's like, come on, we can do this. And I know it was like, it was probably 2 a.m. because we start back for Chicago in this blizzard on I-65. We had both been drinking. Luckily, we could only go like 10 miles an hour. So even if we got an accident, it's like a fender bent. It's like a bump, you know, but it was horrible. And somehow we stayed awake. We probably talked about The Simpsons for 3.5, 5 hours, whatever it was. And we got to your mom's place in Oak Park, and it was light out. So it was morning. But here's the funniest part of the story. Mike and I tried to get to a gas station to call Dave to open his door. Right. So, you know, I can't see. I've had cocktails. The snow's coming down. I make a left-hand turn to get into this gas station, and my Civic goes up on the median strip, and the wheels are, like, going. We're not touching the ground. So now I go, the cops are going to come and bail us out. They're going to see we've been drinking. I'm going to get a DUI. It was horrible, but it was a very fun night in retrospect. A lot of fun.
And then you're in front and you're like, we thought it couldn't get any worse. And then what happened when you looked back to me in the car when you were trying to dig out the wheels?
Oh,
you remember?
No, tell me. I do remember something.
No, you were like, oh, this is terrible. We're going to be, you know, right at the point where we're going to get really angry with each other. You looked over and I'm just howling, laughing, watching you in the warm car, watching you try to dig the wheels out.
Yeah, don't worry, Mike. I got it. I don't even know how we got the car off the...
I don't either. I really don't.
That was a nightmare.
Yeah, that was just the dumb things you do in youth. And also, it's like, now you think about it, hey, let's just, you know, we'll grab a hotel room or whatever.
Yeah.
We didn't have any money, you know, so just like, we got it. We needed that $75 or whatever.
We could get a Super 8. Who's got $30? You know, like, right. What are you, crazy? Oh, that's funny.
That would kill us at this point.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Just like, no way.
What?
But thank God there was nobody else. Everybody with sense was off the road, so we didn't have any problem about running into anyone.
Yeah, and that's really what kind of did it. We were going so slow. It's like, okay. And I think we probably got coffee at that awful gas station. And
rule in stand-up was always like, if I could make it home by 4 a.m. when I lived in Chicago.
Yeah.
Because we had it timed out to every gig. Like St. Louis was about 4.5 hours away. Green Bay, I can make it about 3.5.
Right.
Indy was 3. Detroit was about 4.5.
Right.
So after you finished your set, okay, you looked at your watch and go, if I leave now,
I can be
anything
in my own
to
bed.
Sleep in your own bed.
Yeah.
And I think I pulled over twice and both was coming back from Wisconsin.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I tried to make it back from Green Bay after staying way too long, you know, having cocktails again, having drinks with people and just keep looking at my watch and going, I should take off. I finally had to pull over somewhere around Kenosha with the light coming up and just, I couldn't stay awake anymore.
You know, it's funny. All the people in Wisconsin complain about Illinois people. And it's this kind of fun rivalry, but you're right. People from Illinois always felt targeted by Wisconsin cops. But when I went, I always had Wisconsin plates. Even though I was a transplant here, it was cheaper to register my car here.
Oh, yeah, totally.
So I used my parents' address, even though I had an apartment in Chicago.
I remember that.
Yeah, I got pulled over in Chicago, and the Chicago cops, and I'm like, how do I get out of this? Do I say I'm not really from Wisconsin, or do I just say, oh, I am from Wisconsin. I'm new to this neighborhood. Like, what can I put over on them? But they were really cool, and they just said, you know what? We're going to let you off, but when you go back to Wisconsin, tell them we're not so bad down here in Chicago. Said to me, I was like, done.
That's what he said.
Yeah,
that's great.
Save me $75.
And then you gave him his bribe, and then you went on your way.
No, I gave him the finger and I sped off. So it worked out really well. Spending some time here with Mike Seigel. We didn't even get to all your credits, Mike. You get so many credits. What was your let's just keep it on stand up. What was your favorite club to work?
Looking back, I mean, a few of them were in our area. I mean, there was some places when I'm asked that, people would. You know, they always think it's going to be, oh, the Improv or something like that in Hollywood. It's not. The best clubs I found were like, I remember the old Comedy Cafe in Milwaukee was one of my favorite places to go.
Great club.
Acme in Minneapolis is still there, and it's still one of the best rooms in the country. Places like that. And there's like things like the Treehouse in Bloomington, Indiana. Something like that. You would never.
Wow.
But the crowds are great, and a lot of them has to do with people – the club owners who just cultivate a good crowd that knows comedy and loves comedy. The club owners that just try to get bodies in there and not care who they book, then that breeds, a bad crowd.
Right.
But if they really bring in good comics and thinking, you know, good intellectual comics, but a mix, you know, there's room for everything, but you can tell the club owners that really love comedy and the ones that are just trying to make a buck, you know?
Right.
And the ones that are run and police the room, you know, if people are acting up, like the Comedy and Magic Club here in Hermosa Beach is also one of my favorites. They just bring in a good crowd and the people behave, you know, you rarely get like heckles or drunks or that kind of thing. So that makes it for the best. Some of those rooms are the best. What do you remember?
Yeah, I agree. Comedy Cafe I loved in Milwaukee. I couldn't believe what a great room that was. And I always liked working Madison because I love the city of Madison. But I remember the club was just okay. It's a different club now. The Comedy on State is supposed to be a great room. The room we worked was closer to the Capitol on State Street. And it was an okay room. But it wasn't great. But the Comedy Cafe, I liked Wits End in Denver. The Pittsburgh Funny Bone was good. The clubs I worked in Tampa and West Palm were great. The Comedy Corner.
The Comedy Works in Denver is a famous club, and that's really a great room. And it's still there as well. And, you know, if a club's been open for like 25, 30 years, you know they're doing something right.
Yeah,
you know
for sure. So it's funny you say that, too, about driving, because I remember I left Tampa, and I thought, all right, I'm just going to drive. I'm gonna see how far.
You're gonna drive. Wow. From Tampa.
Yeah, because I went to Pennsylvania, then I went all the way down the East Coast, stopped in North Carolina to see relatives. I worked with Billy Gardell in Pennsylvania. I ended up going down to Florida and working a couple weeks there, and I decided to drive home. I thought I'll make this a little tour. So I leave Tampa, I have dinner, and I keep going. And it's deceptive because you get to Indiana in like 10 or 12 hours, but you still have 6 hours or 5 hours to go to Chicago. And I thought, I can't get a hotel in the state that's right next to the city I live in. So I kept going. I drove 19 straight hours. I was on the Dan Ryan Expressway, and I saw a motorcycle entering the freeway. And I just saw the helmet because the rest of it was blocked. And I thought it was a turkey running across the highway. Like, that's how insane I was. Mike, I got a couple more questions for you. We're going to see what you're up to next. And then we're going to bring in our next guest, a guy from Milwaukee. Mike Kauth is going to join us from Comedy Sports. We're going to learn about that. But right now I'm talking to Mike Seigel. It's Pete Schwabba and Nightlight on the Civic Media Radio Network. Here with If Walls Could Talk host Mike Seigel and what you get for your money. Now, we did cover your shows last week, Mike, but we've been kind of focusing on stand-up comedy, so we'll have to have you back again at some point to talk more about TV. But I want to ask you, you had a development deal when we moved.
I did.
I moved to LA a year before you. We were both at the Montreal Comedy Festival. I was doing cartwheels to try to get people to notice me, and you walked away with a development deal and a lot of money. So I was very happy for you. What I think a lot of people, I don't think this is too inside because of Seinfeld and people see what the process was like. I think they extended the deal too, but that must have been a really cool experience for you. Talk a little bit about what that was like and how close you were to actually having your own show.
Yeah, it was a little. So this is 97. So that's when I went out to L.A. and you had all these meetings. I remember before I went out there, I had like 12 meetings in a week after Montreal. And it ended up being getting a deal with NBC. I got one, and they called it a development deal, but they never really developed anything for me. It was more of like a glorified holding deal. And you learn about Hollywood. A lot of like when they sign people is to keep other people from signing you. You know what I mean? They'll sit down with you and they go, who are you talking to? And you better have an answer.
Yeah.
They want to know that you're talking to other people.
Just my mom on a weekly basis.
Yeah. It's like, so we got to lock this guy up. And so funny thing about that one, I remember, so the first thing, so we're going through pilot season and I'm under contract. So I'd be reading for these sitcoms that are coming out. And, you know, with pilot shows, you know, 90% of them never see the light of day. You don't know what's happening. Even back then, now it's even more, hardly any get on air.
Right.
But I remember the first script I got was for a new show that was coming out, and it was for the lead. And it was to play a gay character. And my manager at the time thought, you know what, right out of the box, you probably shouldn't go for that one. So I didn't read for it. And that was the only one that went on the air and lasted. And that was Will and Grace. So it started well, is what I'm saying.
You don't need that kind of money, Mike. Don't worry about it. We got something else here for you. I got you a walk-on on a VH1 show.
Yeah. So I ended up doing like some little small parts on a pilot that didn't get picked up. I ended up hosting like a hidden camera thing, which was like punked before, you know, reality TV was on networks. And they were like, this has no place on our network. And then a few years later, it's all reality shows, you know, that kind of thing. So it's a typical Hollywood story.
That's
and most things don't go places, you know, they don't. But, you know,
cool
it was an amazing experience. Yeah.
So we just have another minute or two, Mike. If you could host, write, act, or do stand-up, what would you choose if money was no object?
I guess the dream of mine was always to, like, you know, host the Tonight Show and things like that. So, I mean, they always say in comedy, you don't want to be too good an MC. Because they'll keep you at MC, you know, and they'll never move you up. But I mean, there is a skill to it, and the skill to hosting things and keeping shows moving and being able to work with a lot of different kinds of people and interview a lot of different kinds of people. So I was really good with that. So I always wanted to be that kind of, you know, take over. You know, I wanted to be what Jimmy Kimmel had and Fallon. And but they got those gigs. So, I mean, there's only so many of them to go around. But that would have been my ultimate dream to like the host. I wanted to be Letterman, which I think a lot of people our generation did, you know?
Yeah, it's funny. There's like five guys that get to do that. And I think you're doing okay with all the shows you've hosted. And, you know,
I was very fortunate. You know, my first job I ever got was a VH1. So it was a VJ.
Oh, yeah.
Which that was a thing.
Yeah.
But that was the first gig I ever got in TV when I lived in New York. And that's, I got plenty of stories from that, so we can talk about that another
time. We've both been fooling people for a long time, so keep up the good work, buddy. And by the way, you sent me an onion headline. I'm not sure I can read, but I am going to share. I'm going to find out, and then I'll give you credit tomorrow. But the other one I love is, man has bathing suit that's touched his penis. You can borrow. I remember the picture. The guy's looking up with a big smile.
Can I just say my favorite onion photo?
Yeah.
That fun headline. Since it's an election year, the guy walking out of the voting booth and his hair is all disheveled and he's got one eye half open, one eye, and he's clearly, like, you know, way into the bag. And then it just says, and he's wearing a Ralph Nader t-shirt. And underneath it just says, vote, comma, voter, wasted.
That's great.
Vote, voter, wasted.
Mike Seigel, ladies and gentlemen, check out the Travel Tales podcast, and you can find out. He has great guests, and you can find out all the places he's been and, the places you'll go. Thanks so much, Mike. We'll do it again soon.
Thanks. Thanks, Pete. It's great to see you.
Yeah, you too, buddy. All right. So do we have another text, Conrad? Did I miss a text?
No, we do not right now.
Oh, okay. Awesome, then. Let's get right to our next guest. So, this is my first time having someone from ComedySportz on the show. I'm very excited about this. His name is Mike Kauth, and he is a player and the head coach at ComedySportz Milwaukee. So we're going to keep the comedy train rolling here on Nightlight with Pete Schwabba, and welcome Mike Kauth. Hey, Mike.
Hey, Pete. Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
Oh, thanks for waiting. We were just a little behind, but I appreciate your patience, and now we can. Now we're off to the races, buddy. So
yes, sir.
What ComedySportz? So I know.
Yes.
We talked a little bit on the phone about this. Tell everyone who's listening, because I know you guys do shows around the state. It's an improv sketch group, right?
Yes.
So tell people that aren't familiar with ComedySportz a little bit about it.
So what it is it's improvisation. So it's two teams, a red team and a blue team, and they compete in different improvisational games for points and laughs. So the sporting element of it is there's like fouls, there's a referee, and everything is fueled based off of what the audience suggests. So if people have seen like Whose Line Is It Anyway or Wild and Out, it's similar in form to that. But ComedySportz started in Milwaukee, of all places, in 1984.
Wow. Okay. That's a pretty good run you guys have had.
Not too bad.
And it is an actual competition. I remember, I think I told you, when I was in Chicago in the late 80s, I was part of a group called Improv DePaul at DePaul University. Yeah. And a guy came down from Milwaukee to tell us about ComedySportz. He said, we're expanding to Chicago. We got a place on Lincoln Avenue. And we're just putting it out there. If you guys want to come and try out or join us, however it was, he was a pretty cool guy. And that was the first I'd heard of ComedySportz. And I remember thinking, how on earth do you compete? But I'm sure you make it fun. And I always wondered, like after that, I had met people when I was doing stand-up over the years and I'd work in Milwaukee, some ComedySportz people, a lot of people, there was a lot of crossover with stand-up and ComedySportz. So we'll talk about that too. And I want to ask you more about the competition and just the history of your group, because that's pretty cool. You founded like, you guys founded like your own Groundlings or Second City right there in Milwaukee. And it's been a great breeding ground. So you've already hung with me this long, Mike. We gotta do a quick break and then we're going to come back and we'll close out the show with Mike Kauth from ComedySportz in Milwaukee. This is Pete Schwabba and Nightlight on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Since I met this little woman, I feel it's happened to me. And I'm telling you, it's too late to turn back now. I believe, I believe, I believe I'm falling in love. It's too late to turn back now. I believe, I believe, I believe I'm falling in love. I found myself phoning her at least 10 times.
Tonight's question, in the spirit of National Plan a Vacation Day, if you could go anywhere in the world at no cost, where would you go? Still not too late. We got some, we don't usually get as many texts in the second hour, but we got a few tonight. You can reach us at 844-967-2789, 844-96-PARTY. And this is from the 715. I would definitely go to Key West for a vacation. It's a little basic, but it's gorgeous and isolating. Reading on the beach sounds pretty sweet. Boy, I can't complain about that. That sounds, I could not disagree. As usual, great text tonight. And helping me close out the show tonight is another funny guy. We had Mike Seigel on, who's very funny. And now I've got another guy who is funny himself and also teaches funny in Milwaukee at ComedySportz, Mike Kauth. Welcome back, Mike.
Hey, thanks, Pete. Happy to be here.
Yeah. So tell us a little bit about how does the competition work? Because that, I will admit, when I was 19 years old or whatever, I'm like, how do you compete at improv? And like, I'm sure the ref is funny and the whole thing is like a big sketch. Mm-hmm. But how does that work?
Yeah. Some of that competition is just a way to get humor in, like you're kind of saying, you know. Some of it is like we choose games where we pit the different performers up against each other, trying to like kind of out-clever one another. So that's kind of like the competition aspect of it. But truthfully, the whole thing with it being improv is it's supportive. So you're setting each other up to look good.
Yeah.
The sporting and the competition aspect of it is kind of our way in to find comedy. So it can get a little bit competitive with some of the games, but you try and, you know, play to win, but don't care if you lose kind of a thing.
Yeah, sure. It's all entertaining and it's all in good fun.
Yeah. It can be fun to lose sometimes, you know?
Yeah. Where are you located in Milwaukee, Mike? Where are the,
we're at 420 South First Street. Okay. Right in kind of the Fifth Ward area of Milwaukee.
So how did, you know, when you were in your infancy, and I don't know how long you've been with the group, but talk about how it's grown and how cool was that to see? Because you're kind of, you know, improv's not new, sketch isn't new, but you guys have made this, you're a staple in Milwaukee now. Like, how cool is that?
Yeah, it's really nice. And it was something that there's people, because I started taking classes in 99. So 25 years ago, I started getting involved with ComedySportz, and they had already established themselves as like a killer comedy space in Milwaukee. And going to see shows and seeing some of the people, like you and I have a friend in common, Eric Price.
I was just going to mention him. What a hilarious guy.
Amazing. Yeah, he was so funny. And I was able, like when I was taking classes, I had him as an instructor, and seeing him on stage, you know, pretty much every weekend was pretty great. And like learning from those people, and you see kind of like the evolution of it is sort of how comedy changes as well. So you see kind of people's attention spans get a little bit shorter.
Yeah.
So some of the elements of the show start to change a little bit. Sometimes we don't do games as long as we used to. We try and keep it moving as quickly as we can and keep everyone engaged.
You know, it's so funny you mentioned Eric. I was going to mention him. And as funny as he is, and equally just a great guy. Yes. But here's a testament to ComedySportz. And some of this is natural because Eric's a naturally funny guy. But I did a movie several years ago up here in Northeast Wisconsin called The Godfather of Green Bay. We found Eric in Milwaukee. It was like a slam dunk. We couldn't believe how funny he was. He got the role. He comes up here. And he joined a cast that had some pretty heavy hitters in comedy, one of which was Thomas Lennon from The State, and he was on Reno 911. And Tom is one of the funniest people you'll meet. Very dry, very sarcastic. Love him. And Eric starts doing bits, kind of characters, whatever, in this bar we were hanging out with. I'm like, oh, this is gutsy, man. I don't know if he realizes. Yeah. Okay, so he does this character. He does this bit where he's out in the street getting hit by cars and messing with people and everything, and everybody is in stitches. And I was like, that is a funny guy. Someone who can bring that improv and those skills and off-the-cuff stuff to a set full of funny, established people already and just crush it. And that's kind of a testament to ComedySportz.
Yeah, it's one of those things like that. Improv training is great. Like it's come in handy so many times. And it's just like, because you never know where you're going to be. You know, I was thinking about this today because it's like there's so many different places that I've done shows. And it's just like you're saying, you have to be ready to go anywhere. We've done shows like on a boat, which is always interesting with the waves crashing down. Yeah. The weirdest one was probably on a bus, where there's a moving bus, and you know, it's like, it's one thing to, you know, it's weird in general, but like stand up, you can stand there, you've got the microphone, you're telling your jokes. Right. With improv, we're trying to act out scenes, in the aisle of a bus, and I'm a big guy, so I'm already taking up the full aisle. So I have another guy basically on my shoulders, and we're trying to do this whole show.
What was the was it like a, was that the gig? The bus was like a ComedySportz bus tour or something, or were you just goofing on a city bus, or what do you mean?
Yeah, we do private shows as well. So like if companies hire us out, like corporate gigs or a family reunion or something like that, we'll go and do shows. And they called us up and they were like, hey, I could be wrong about this, but I believe they were in Green Bay and they were going to Milwaukee. And they're like, can you fill that time with some improv comedy?
Oh, wow.
And we're like, okay. So we get on the bus in Green Bay and just pray that it didn't hit traffic, you know?
Right. That would be a nightmare. That's like when you're doing stand-up and you know, the guy that's coming on after you is in the bathroom with the runs or something, and they're telling you to stretch, and you're like, oh, dear God. So that's pretty cool. So talk about a little bit. Why do people, like, you've probably seen an assortment of people, Mike, that joined ComedySportz for actually a variety of reasons. I assume everybody that takes the training isn't just trying to be a successful actor or comedian or just be famous. You probably have people that take it just to be better at thinking on their feet or have improv skills in the workplace. What kind of breakdown is that?
Yeah, 100%. Like what you said, like some people obviously like get the performance bug, and other people, I was just talking to a lady 2 weeks ago who just started taking the 101 workshop that we offer. And she's like, I'm in front of people all the time. I'm giving presentations on a regular basis. I feel comfortable when I'm in front of people. I just want to figure out how to, like, you know, manage that. And improv skills can help just like get comfortable focusing on like being in front of people and talking and giving some like tips and tricks to just get comfortable.
That's great. And it's very, I mean, that's invaluable because it can help you in any walk of life.
Right.
You mentioned you guys travel around the state. Where can people see shows around the state? Do you do it regularly? Do you have a schedule, or how can people find out more about that?
Yeah. Our shows are set regularly in Milwaukee. Right. Which are Friday nights and Saturday nights, 7:30 and 10 o'clock. And then we have like a secondary stage where there's stand-up, sketch comedy, other like long-form improv that happens. And that you would check out like CSZMKE.com to check out that schedule. And as far as around the state, like with Comedy Sports, we're willing to go where everybody, when anyone wants us. Okay. So if like we've gone up to Stevens Point for the colleges up there, definitely been in Green Bay, Sheboygan, you know, if you're willing to pay us and maybe even feed us, we're happy to show up.
I can't give you a signing bonus or a per diem or anything, but you see the space here behind me because we're on video. We would love to have you guys perform in here one time if you could, if we could figure out something, or if you're coming through anyway, it'd be great to have you in the studio and, bring some
funny. That'd be super fun.
Yeah. My guest is Mike Kauth. He is one of the players and the head coach at ComedySportz Milwaukee. So we talked a little bit, Mike, about like Groundlings in LA, Second City in Chicago. How is the ComedySportz brand different than those two entities?
Yeah.
If at all.
With I think Groundlings and with Second City, their improv is kind of a tool to sketch comedy, or it's a tool to like characters. And with ComedySportz, like improv is kind of the beginning, middle, and end of it. So it's kind of using improv as the comedy tool itself in those fast, quick-paced moments. And something that is nice with ComedySportz is it's all age appropriate. So, you know, you can bring anybody to a ComedySportz show. No one's going to get offended, ideally. And if they do, we have the frown bag foul. And then if someone says something inappropriate, they have to wear the bag on their head.
So. I imagine you open yourself up to wider audiences with that. And so the shows are pretty much PG. PG-13, yes. Right? Okay.
Yeah, that's nice. Exactly. I didn't know that. Okay. And that's something like the creator of ComedySportz, Dick Chudnow, really wanted to hang his hat on, of just like, let's create a comedy show that anybody can show up to and nobody has to feel like uncomfortable or anybody has to worry about language or anything like that. So, and that, you know, that presents its own challenges as well.
Of sure.
Just like in the moment, how can we, you know, like, you never want to cross the line. Some audiences want you to get close to it. So you're just kind of dancing around, making sure everybody gets the laughs they want.
You can't rely on an F-bomb to bail you out or just being crude for the sake of being crude. Can you tell us, what are some of the success stories from ComedySportz? I mean, anyone who does it is a success on some level, but have you had people go on to do much bigger and better things? Eric is one of them. He's had a lot of success, but what are some other stories?
Yeah, Eric Price. We have someone I came up with, Dave Tooney, who is, you probably wouldn't recognize the name perchance, but like his face, he's in a lot of different shows. He's appeared in like The Big Bang Theory.
Oh, nice.
And probably the biggest one from Milwaukee is Dan Harmon. So Dan Harmon, who created Community and Rick and Morty.
Yeah.
Yeah, he came up, I believe, like through our high school league and then became one of the professional pro players. And and it's fun to see that. And him, along with Rob Schraub, who is a creative partner of his on Monster House. And Rob went on to have great success as well.
That's so cool. So it's nice that you have a network and people that go through there have that kind of like a college alumni association. Are those guys good about booking ComedySportz people, you know, bringing them onto the show as guest stars and that kind of stuff?
Yeah. When Dan Harmon created the Sarah Silverman show, Rob Schraub was directing that. I believe he co-created that as well. And they brought on Kurt Scholer, who is another very funny character actor who lives out in Los Angeles. A guest of yours, like Tom Clark. I know like he's been a part of.
Was he a ComedySportz guy?
He was. Okay. Yeah.
Nice.
That's how I met a lot of these people.
I'm going to see Tom this weekend, this coming Saturday night. He's doing a fundraiser that he agreed to do that I put together every year, the talent part of it anyway. So he's going to be up in the Marinette area with his wife, Steph, and I can't wait to see him. And another comic, nice. Tim Cavanaugh, is across town doing a Catholic school thing. So this is going to be like the Hollywood of Wisconsin for one weekend. But yeah, Tom's a great guy. I didn't know he did comedy sports, though. That's cool.
Yeah. Is there, and forgive me, I'm just curious, like your event, is there a way like people can get tickets to that? Or
well,
is there...
that's interesting. I know Tom is going to be performing in Milwaukee on Friday night, the night before he goes up to Marinette. So, and I know he said there were a few tickets left on Facebook. I don't know when that was, maybe a day or two ago. So that would probably be a better bet. This is like a fundraiser for a local football club that I don't really have much to do with, but they just asked me to bring friends of mine in. And I'm the guy with all the sweet hookups. But if people are willing to drive to Marinette, contact me. I'll definitely ask if there are still tickets. I know there were earlier in the week, but they do tend to pack them in. But it's a really fun event. And is Milwaukee, would you say, a pretty good training ground for actors in general?
I think so. You know, like I've walked away with a lot of information and talent, talented people teaching me, showing me the ropes and everything and building that confidence. And it's one of those things, like, as you know, like comedians tend to make good dramatic actors.
Yeah, they do. Hey, Mike, hold that thought, because I want you to elaborate on that, but we just have to do something really quick here. And my guest is Mike Kauth. He's with ComedySportz in Milwaukee, and we're going to find out what he's watching, too. I want Mike to give us some recommendations on what he's binging on or what he's cringing on after we talk a little more ComedySportz. This is Pete Schwabba and Nightlight on the Civic Media Radio Network.
I can't hear a sound, folks talking loud, but I don't see at all. I gotta get away, gotta get away. I don't
know where to go. It's hopeless, so I guess I'll leave it alone.
Winding down the second hour of Nightlight here. Got another text here from the 920. Steve says, Ireland. I hear the residents are very friendly and great pubs and golf. That sounds like a fun trip. We have pretty good suggestions tonight. And I think I'm just going to settle on Italy. I'll go to Italy. That's generic. Everybody wants to go to Italy, but I haven't been too many places. Mike, where would you go? Where, if money were no object, what would you take a trip?
I would love to visit London. I'm a big, when you're talking about like things to watch and everything, my mind starts jumping around. I'm a big fan of British television.
Yeah. What shows? What do you like?
Have you ever watched Toast of London?
I have not.
Yes. I'd recommend that. It's a very funny comedian, Matt Berry. He's a musician, comedian, actor. Yeah. People would probably know him from like What We Do in the Shadows.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Yeah, he's on that. Very funny, just absurdist. I would recommend everyone check out Toast of London. Very unique voice. And it's like, that's one of those things when in comedy, it's just hard to find like a unique voice and perspective. Right. And when you see something like that, or it's just like, oh, they know exactly what they're going for, what the voice and tone is.
Yeah.
That excites me to see stuff like that.
Speaking of like British humor, the original Office, I was such a fan of. There was 12 episodes. They were all tight. Ricky Gervais is hilarious. It's just such a great show. But talk about bringing improv skills to television and what they did in the American Office. I think I just talked about this last week with someone. I kind of boycotted the American Office at first, but man, did they crush it too. Just, I know they had to stretch it out into 9 seasons, but Steve Carell, Ed Helms, Rainn Wilson, such great improvers. And I mean, talk about that sketch background. That's invaluable, right? They're big stars, but still.
For sure. And that's one of those things that I always get a kick out of is so many of the big stars, like comedy stars, like started out with a background in improvisation. Like you were saying, like the Groundlings, Second City, all that stuff is improv training. So that's always a kick to see something like that. And I was like you. I was like, when the American Office started, it's like, no thanks. But then giving it a chance and be like, okay, I see. I get it. They put their own spin on it. Yeah.
They definitely did. And, you know, it's funny. We were talking about Milwaukee as a training ground for young actors. And I think my experience there working the Comedy Cafe, I met a lot of guys that did improv as well, like the Brady Street guys. I don't know if they're still around, but they were great guys. And they also kind of dabbled in stand-up too. And in Chicago, it seemed like there was more of a rivalry. There were like stand-ups and then improv, you know. But there was a lot of crossover. Like Bob Odenkirk did both. And I know my friend Peter Moore and his wife Rami did both. And a lot, there was just a whole bunch of, I mean, if you can do both, that's pretty amazing. But what would you tell someone who was funny and young? How would you send them on their way to finding their voice in comedy? Would it be through improv? Would it be through stand-up or just serious acting classes? What would you say to them?
Yeah, that's it's going to be kind of like up to the individual, which is kind of a generic answer. But like, I always encourage everyone to take an improv class, because I think like you're saying, discovering your voice, you're doing it on the fly and you get to try different kind of characters, different point of view. And the nice thing about starting out with improv is like stand-up is intimidating in my opinion, because it's just you up there. Whereas improv, if you're dipping your toe into it and you want to get into comedy and performing, it's like, here's a group of people who are going to support each other, where you can kind of pass the ball to somebody and they get a chance to be funny. And ideally they pass it right back to you. And so it's a little more building together than just like, all right, go.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. It's so funny you say that. My son is getting to that age now where he's trying to figure out what he's going to do. And I keep saying, even though I came up through the stand-up ranks and I don't have any regrets, I loved it. I love my comedian friends. They're still my lifelong best friends. But I tell him, you know, what I didn't know when I was younger is that all those people doing Second City or ComedySportz or whatever, they're getting called in by ad agencies. They're getting auditions for Chicago Fire, Chicago Police, or whatever it is. And I'm sure it's the same way in Milwaukee. You get commercial auditions. Like, those are great training grounds. And, you know, I would say, and it's a network too. It's stand-up. Yeah. You really are on an island and you network a little bit. But yeah, that improv training is invaluable. And that's where the reason I asked you that is because that's where I'm steering my own son, even though my background is in stand-up. So.
Yeah, I would encourage him to try it, because, again, like, you get to find your own voice. And exactly like you're saying, like, I lucked out being able to do a couple commercial things here and there, because sometimes it's like they don't have the full script. So it's like, we have this idea, we're going to bring you in, and they rely on you to kind of fill in those blanks.
Or you get, you know, if someone is a good improver and someone is a smart director, they will give you gold. Like, I remember when I would stuff I would write early in my career, I would say, this is the script. I know what I'm doing, because you're young and cocky. And then you realize, oh my gosh, you're getting free. And Eric Price is a great example. He brought so much to the role he did. Tom Lennon, all these guys. And you should cast people like that, because they are going to elevate these roles because of that background they have.
Yeah. And that was something I mentioned to you. Like, I was lucky enough where saw a premiere at the Oriental Theater in Milwaukee of Godfather and Green Bay.
Oh, no kidding. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And I'm sure I met you way back then.
Probably, yeah.
And that was the thing, is you had so many, it was like a funny script, a fun movie, and you surrounded yourself with really talented people. And I just remember how, like, it's got to be a different experience for you, but it just felt so electric, because like, nobody had seen the movie before. Everyone's there to support it and cheer it on, and then it delivers. So that's got to be like, that's got to be pretty cool.
It really was. It was incredibly collaborative, and you cast guys like Eric or Lance Barber, who was on the show a couple weeks ago, and you just, you know, you sit in a coffee shop or at your desk and you write something and you think it's funny, but when you put the faces to it and when they bring stuff you didn't anticipate, it's just amazing. And I'm sure you witnessed that on a nightly basis at ComedySportz. I recommend everybody check it out. Mike, it's been great hanging with you tonight. Please come back again and let's do it again soon.
That sounds great. Thank you, Pete.
You got it. Have a great night. That's Mike Kauth of Comedy Sports Milwaukee. Check it out. I'd like to thank all my guests tonight. Mike Seigel, Mike Kauth. Great texts from everybody. And tomorrow night, we got another fun. Kristen Lyerly will be here. And then on Thursday night, Rachel Manick from the Fox 11 Morning Show will be here in studio hanging out with me on Thursday night. So much fun tonight. Thanks for being with me on Nightlight. Good night, Wisconsin.